Okay, good morning. Today is 2/2/23, February, not September, February 2, 2023. Moving right along. The title of today's talk is the working title is Anicca and Eating Bitter. You may notice the profusion of creative titlings that I enjoy. Comments on the Chinese phrase chi ku, eat bitter, chi as eat, ku as bitter, translated by Cheng Manqing, who was a top-level Tai Chi, Qigong master, I think from China and Taiwan. Cheng Manqing looked like a very good friend of mine from high school. He translated chi ku as invest in loss. And I'll look at that. Discussion of the aphorism, assume loss, meaning we're going to be discussing the phrase assume loss and the critical importance to spiritual development of understanding impermanence, which is anicca in Buddhist Pali language. And so, what's going on here? Well, I was thinking recently about the inevitability of change or the loss of the pleasant, the pleasurable mind states that arise now and then or regularly, meaning I'm feeling well. Hey. Well, these are impermanent mind states, or all phenomena is transitory. It arises, persists, and passes away. We know that intellectually. We don't necessarily. We don't necessarily know it in emotionally and viscerally. Knowing intellectually is not the same as a visceral, grounded knowing. Visceral in the body, deep centered knowing is affects the emotional. I feel less disappointment because I know that all happiness is transitory. Like that. And the phrase that came to my mind immediately was assume loss, or how do we deal with this? Assume loss means assume the loss of what you want. Now, that again has to be qualified. The phrase, Chen Manqing's translation of chi ku, which is simply eat bitter, translation into invest in loss, which I'm going to present one of his students' commentaries on that. That itself needs to be unpacked. So every pithy aphorism needs to be unpacked to understand the meaning and application. Deeper meanings or the range of meanings, a range of meanings and applications to relevant to personal life. All phenomena are impermanent, whatever subject to arising, subject to passing away. Knowing that viscerally is will be measured by the degree of the degree to which we fall into discouragement and disappointment in the face of changing conditions, particularly the loss of happiness and well-being. The first flush of love, the honeymoon phase, the initial burst of joy acquiring an item that I think I like so much. Oh, this jade bracelet is so lovely. Or whatever one wants. Falling out of love. These types of experiences, the gradual lessening of the happiness of pleasure and gain and praise and honor, all right, the four of the happy worldly winds, to the degree that we can be at peace or be not terribly upset by inevitable loss of good, the inevitable changing of mind states equals the loss of happiness. It doesn't mean we live in hell. It just means that all pleasurable, kusala dhamma, states are impermanent to the degree that we're not yet fully enlightened and beyond, impermanence. So, then we would be naturally less emotionally upset. And that shows, I'd say, a more visceral, centered, grounded, embodied knowing. Not the same as intellectual knowing, it's deep knowing. Then the phrase assume loss is important. Assume change, which equals the loss, to some degree, of the feelings associated with happiness and pleasure and gain and praise and whatever you like. Assume loss is and under it requires, of course, or is an understanding of Nietzsche. And I believe Gautama said, I'm not 100% sure, but I'm kind of sure, Gautama actually said something like, if one understands a Nietzsche impermanence, one can understand the whole of the Buddha Dhamma. The whole of the Tathagata's teaching can be understood by a profound and deep understanding of a Nietzsche impermanence. Because actually, by a Nietzsche, one will understand the other two characteristics, meaning anatta, no self, and dukkha, suffering or stress or dissatisfactoriness. That all phenomena are transitory is itself a basis for stress or dissatisfaction. That all phenomena are indeed transitory. Actually, when you really look into the nature of that which appears to be transitory, what appears to be transitory is itself transitory. And actually, there's reification. Meaning, we're assuming or we're perceiving things changing. But actually, that which appears to be changing itself is changing, meaning there's not a solid object changing, there's change. There's changing appearance, there's changing form, and then there's changing, phenomenal experience outside and inside too. My anger will lessen, my joy or happiness will lessen, lessen, over time, because they're impermanent mind states. My joy, my well-being, my satisfaction, my fulfillment may well, a certain quality, certain types of sukha will pass away fast or pass away observably or change and lessen. Other kind of well-being is different. That's equanimity. That's a little bit different. So upekkha, equanimity, serenity, samatha, states of samadhi as a long-term conditions. They also are impermanent, but they last much longer. It's different than sukha associated with acquisition or achievement of a physical activity. It's a very subtle difference. There's short-term sukha and long-term sukha. Sukha as pleasure or well-being. Short-term is associated with physical activity. Long-term is associated with spiritually based mind states. Changes of mind catalyzed by physical gain is short term. Changes in mind catalyzed by spiritual reorientation or consciousness transformations are long term, if you know what I mean. So assume loss is useful. Chong Man Ching, mistranslated, or as a typical everybody does this, it's just the vast sinkhole of mistranslation or distranslation, dystopic translation. He translated chi ku as invest in loss. It's not invest in loss, it's eat bitter. But there's a topic, a page. Man named Scott Park Phillips looks a little like a friend of mine and looks a little like Robin Williams, so probably a wanderer. December 19, 2012, he said, I've written about this topic before. I recommend you go over to the Yang Family Tai Chi Forum and read what expert translators, ooh, say invest in loss means. Yang family is Cheng Wanqing's lineage of Tai Chi teaching. Here's the question, or here's a something he put in here. Somebody named Mark Hennessy translated. This is the quote. I am told of a quote from Cheng Wanqing, quote, "Moreover, a beginner cannot possibly avoid losing and defeat. So if you fear defeat, you may as well not even begin. If you want to study, begin by investing in loss. An investment in loss eliminates any greed for superficial advantages. Concentrating your chi to become soft is the only proper method to invest in loss." So he's translated chi ku, eat bitter, as invest in loss. It means assume there'll be loss. Where he's saying don't fear defeat. A beginner cannot possibly avoid losing and defeat. Maybe everyone but the fully enlightened won't be able to avoid loss and defeat. That all mind states are impermanent means the ones you prefer will change and thus be lost. Losing the positive mind states as a gain, their change as a loss. Right. So positive or positive in the sense of egosyntonic or what I like, preferred mind states. There are many of them. Pleasure, happiness, joy, love, kindliness, warmth, affection, bliss, ecstasy, up the ladder. These preferred mind states are not a problem. They're wonderful. What's commonly felt to be a problem is the fact that they're transitory and degrade. And that making peace with that inevitable degradation, which is felt as a loss, is the basis of eat bitter. And so applying Cheng Manqing's guidance for Tai Chi or Bagua practitioners to us, not being martial artists, but seekers of love light. If you fear defeat, you're gonna have a hard time. One cannot possibly avoid loss of the inevitably the intrinsically impermanent preferred mind states or world conditions. Beautiful women lose their beauty, handsome men lose their handsome, wealthy people age or bodies age, and today's five-star dinner is fetid shit tomorrow in the toilet. That's just the way it is here. And that doesn't, that's not a call to bitterness or nihilistic resignation or depression or anything. It's just accepting the reality of phenomenal process in this dimension is akin to invest in loss, is akin to learning the way of Chi Ku. And he's saying, if you want to study, begin by investing in loss. Investment in loss eliminates any greed for superficial advantages. Well, it's an except. I don't know. Greed is not a good idea, of course. But sometimes we feel greedy. Superficial advantage is that there's advantage and there's gain, but it's always impermanent. That just should be known. And the guidance here is concentrating your chi to become soft is the only proper method to invest in loss. Translated, the only way to truly learn to eat bitter, to learn to make peace with eating bitter, is concentrating your chi and becoming soft. And that's Wu Wei. And that is associated with, not fighting when fighting is futile, and having a healthy wariness of grasping and aversion. Sometimes I'm full of anger, or I feel anger or hate or loathing or angry or frustrated. Okay. Sometimes I feel great longing or lust or desire or hunger or emptiness or dissatisfaction. Okay. Understand that we regularly get stuck and we can yet pull out of getting stuck by accepting and stop and not struggling. And so stop struggling is part of how one learns to eat bitter. So he goes on, invest in loss is an expression which has become very widespread as part of an English language explanation of Tai Chi push hands, Bagua also. As Lewis Swaim or Swain explains, it's two characters, eat and loss, chi, ku. Any fluent Chinese speaker would hear that, eat bitter. It's not even, it's not eat loss, it's eat bitter. And then he's talking about how to apply it to Tai Chi practice. And relates it to Muhammad Ali saying, don't quit. Suffer now and live the rest of your life as a champ, meaning take your lumps and keep going, pay your dues, dot dot dot. He gives the example, somebody named Paul Cohen gives the example, tells a story of Gu Jian, some character in Chinese history, saying he was conquered. I mean, he was either a military or a leader, political leader. Not clear here. Guo Jian was conquered. He totally accepted the most humiliating subordination for years before getting his kingdom back by trickery. Then he secretly plotted a strategy of total revenge over 20 years. The way he kept himself focused on the task of revenge, the task of revenge, was by wearing furs in summer and going bare-chested in winter, by hanging an extremely bitter gallbladder, meaning some animal's gallbladder, from his doorway, which he would lick every time he walked under it, licking the bitter. So eating bitter or eating loss means to accept public def accept defeat publicly while secretly planning total revenge. Okay. So that's his interpretation of ku chi or chi ku. Accept defeat publicly while secretly planning totally revenge, total revenge. Well, that's one way of looking at it. I'm not recommending planning total revenge because you'll just go depolarizing. So, okay, that's his understanding, or maybe that's how it's done in martial arts. Making peace with the inevitability of the worldly win, the unpleasant or difficult worldly wins, the worldly wins we find unpleasant or difficult. Loss, pain, blame, and dishonor. Accepting that what we like will pass away, or pleasurable mind states will pass away. And unpleasant mind states will pass away. Everything in its time, seasons of the spirit, the cycles of time, and this knowing that more deeply is associated with this phrase, assume loss. Assume there'll be loss. But that doesn't mean becoming morbid, or depressive, or depressed, or it's not necessary at all. Gautama is not saying you should all be depressed and you'll understand my Dharma. No, understanding impermanence really, really well. Then there's another web page about West from West China tea. So they understand about bitter also. There's a saying in China, this is another link I'll give you. Bu ku bu shi cha. Bu ku bu shi cha. If it isn't bitter, it isn't tea. If it isn't bitter, it isn't 3D, I'd say. And if it isn't bitter, it isn't tea. If you aren't suffering, you aren't living. If it isn't dukkha, it isn't. There's no existence prior to enlightenment without dukkha. That's where you get anicca anatta dukkha and the Four Noble Truths. The first noble truth is the truth of dukkha. Which is not, and so everybody, most people don't understand so deeply. In this page also, it says, they say, In Buddhism, the first of the Four Noble Truths simply states life is suffering. No, life is dukkha. Or conditioned experience is dukkha. Dukkha is not best translated as suffering because, again, higher self and beings in quite blissful higher dimensions still are subject to dukkha, of course, because there is an intrinsic dissatisfactoriness to the reality or the continued experience of a loss and impermanence. Impermanence equals loss, loss of what you don't want. It's also gain. The gain of what you like keeps coming too. And then it's loss. But that whole plus and minus is a minus. That's called dukkha, meaning the cycle of birth and death, the cycle of gain and loss, the cycle of pleasure and its degradation and dissolution, where you no longer feel the pleasure or happiness or joy or bliss. That cycle, alternation process, that polarity, continually, regularly, seeking, finding, degrading, losing. The degrading is the degradation of the mind states that come from successful finding. So, dissatisfaction, formation of desire, clinging, craving, acquisition, at best, pleasure upon acquisition, at worst, frustration or pain upon inability to acquire. With acquisition of objects of desire, there's the change of the mind states. That the happiness of when I first bought it goes away, the happiness of the honeymoon phase goes away. Now I see he, she is the way I didn't know before. No longer on the best behavior, we see partnership or relationship in a sobered way, soberly, rather than from an idealizing. So that's the reality of impermanence for that which we want. Because you see, nobody seeks the capture of an object of desire. Right, the object of attention is in this case an object of desire for acquisition or something associated with trying to get rid of my painful state where I feel like I want something, I want this or that, then I'll be happy. Then I'll be forever happy, is the thought, by the way. That's why Gautama said, if you understand impermanence, you'll know the whole of my teaching. Because we actually don't really, we pay only lip service in our intellectual acquiescence or recognition. Yes, of course, everything's changing. Everything's changing, of course, of course, of course. But when we say, I want this, we're not saying, I want this whose result will be a happiness that degrades. Ah, that doesn't sound fun. Hey, man, you're such a bummer. Party pooper. Don't rain on my parade. So, yeah, we seek for the happiness that we feel will be abiding, but it isn't. It's never. No states are abiding. They're all impermanent. So nobody thinks, I want to get this for a temporary happiness that'll lead to a dissatisfaction and a further seeking and a further hungering, craving, tanha beyond that. No. We think, I'm going to go get it. Then I'll be happy, in parentheses, unendingly? Something like that. And so, okay, the first noble truth is that conditioned experience is dukkha. And then there's a lot of comments here on Chinese culture. And, this is not a bad point from this West China tea, their perspective here. Anyone who has spent time in China knows that Chinese people are not a miserable people. They're actually far less depressive than Eastern Europeans and Slavs and Scandinavians, who are much more morose, I think. He goes on, laughing, smiling, dancing, especially old ladies, singing, karaoke, getting drunk, eating delicious food, being with family and friends. These are pretty much the main things Chinese people are into. But they do not, in general, agonize over their suffering, but rather accept it as inevitability, as much as the sun setting at night. They will avoid hardship and suffering at all costs, or to some degree, as any organism will, but they do not, in my experience, the author here, tend to perform a, quote, grand reckoning of their joy and sorrow and evaluate from it whether they're in the black or and that their life is worth living. He's talking about a certain Westerner neurotic pattern of measuring one's success, one's value by a certain kind of moral success, updating, continued taking stock. It's sort of like checking your net asset value every 6 hours. Chinese don't do that as much. I think that's true, except for those that are super wealthy and have a lot to lose. But other than that, yeah, there is a sort of acceptance that shit happens. You got to eat the bitter sometimes. You have to. We have to. Or we get bitter regularly, which is the loss of pleasure or happiness and well-being. And also the fact that, you know, we regularly will have to experience what we don't want. We get what we don't want. We lose what we want that we've gotten, or it changes, or the mind state changes. Objects change. Mind states change. Kamaloka here, third density, is very much of insatiable desire. That's why it's called Kama Loka, the realm of desire, desire loka, realm. That's associated with the desire is the offspring of continual restlessness and a sense of insufficiency, inadequacy, existential insufficiency, which is not unusual, which is, you know, inevitable to seven-dimensional life, actually. It's called seeking. There's either, though, seeking wisely or seeking unwisely. Seeking in a self-harming or a self-empowering way. Seeking to my that is to my long-term welfare and benefit, or seeking that's to a short-term welfare and benefit, or seeking that is to no benefit, or seeking to that which is actually harmful or perilous. Chalaboy, chalabos. Meaning dangerous, perilous related seeking. Seeking, you know, death-defying thrill. But in general, at this time in history, when we open the focus a little bit to here at the end times of third density, conditions are very unstable. I mean, there are a lot of people passing out of the world, if you understand what I'm saying, being culled and liberated from the body, despite what they, though they don't want it. A lot of people dying. A lot of people breaking down mentally. A lot of people sick physically. A lot of people in mental, emotional distress of one sort. A lot of people confused. A lot of people fighting and arguing and opinionated dogmatism, dogmatically struggling with each other. A lot of people with their head in the sand. A lot of people who seem to be okay. Maybe the majority. But who knows, right? When you see them on the street, you don't really know unless you can read their mind or in their and their energy fields. You don't really know. We don't really know where they're at. We can if we can read their mind from their face, and that's doable. But I think there was Plato said, or someone said, you know, don't be, maybe it's Paul, or maybe it's in the Bible, something like, be kind to people, for everyone is facing a hard struggle or hard challenge. Be kind to people because they're having a hard time too, and we're having a hard time too, somewhat, some degree. And that's again going to be related to people, place, and work. Do you have people in your life that are giving you trouble? Do you have people in your life that you'd rather not meet? Well, do you really need to meet them or see them as much as you do? Why are they in your life? Do they have to be? If they do have to be, maybe from family or work obligation, how can I minimize the dukkha of being with them? Then there's place and where I live, where I go. Does that fit you? Does it not? Can a change be made? Can some changes to your home be made? Is your room filthy? Is your car a mess? Call 1-800. Something like that. Call your soul. Call your conscience. Call the mirror. Do you have a problem? Call the mirror. Look into it. and discover the problem and its solution, or wait and it'll arise if you keep seeking it. And then work is like, what are you doing every day? Is it really in line with your values? Do you value what you're doing? Is what you're doing, do you feel good about yourself doing what you're doing? Do you feel guilty? Do you feel useless? Do you feel unfulfilled? What is it? Know where you're coming from. And so if you want more light, find more dark. Yes. If you want more light and well-being, find how you're confused and in some dismay or distress or unwell. Look into the dark to amplify, to grow greater light. And that's the big difference between spiritual bypassers and those willing to face the shadow or know themselves deeply with rigorous honesty, as Ross said. It's difficult. Absolutely. It's not hard for me to talk for an hour, but I'm not perfect in my life, bippity-boppity joy all the time either. But you know, great masters are not that way either. So we have some misunderstanding. I had a session with somebody who's saying, well, if I do this and that, I can be in joy and happiness. You know, you can't just, I don't think that's invest in loss or assume loss or eat bitter. Also means that it's not realistic to assume that the more free and well and balanced, healing and balance, more healed and more balanced one is, the more one is in joy and bliss. One may be in equanimity. There's deep well-being from a quiet mind. There's deep well-being from a peaceful heart, an open heart, a peaceful mind, a clear mind, clear capacity for thinking, clearly knowing when needed, as much as one can, at least to resolve confusion to a adequately, sufficiently resolving confusion. I know I don't know everything, therefore I have confusion on many points, but I've adequately answered my doubts or wonderings to get beyond the distressing levels of confusion. The levels of confusion or not knowing that are distressing. There are other levels of knowing or levels of confusion or qualities of confusion that are not distressing. It's not distressing to me that I don't know all the details of all my past lives. It was distressing to me in years past that I didn't know some. Now I know the sum that eliminates the distressing levels of, or you know, portions of confusion. Deeper levels of confusion or not knowing are not so distressing. I know I won't know till I'm out of here. Fine, no problem. So resolve confu the d resolve distressing confusion. And don't worry about unknowing that which is not distressing. Something like that. So at some level, that too is a kind of chikku or accepting bitterness. The bitterness for the one who wants to know everything, or doesn't want to admit, I don't know, of the reality that full knowing is impossible, understanding is not of your density, as Ross said. But we can have sufficient understanding and knowing to resolve distressing confusion, where there will be other levels of not knowing that could be called confusion that are not distressing, and it's fine, and that's that. So we're orders of a magnitude above and beyond the dogmatists here, but they're in much distress and they just keep fighting. Then there's a page from, I think it's a, I'm not sure who, it's a woman who didn't put her name on the front of it here. The website's called Untigering: Adventures of a Deconstructing Tiger Mother. Probably a, maybe a Chinese woman who's been a mother who, while recognizing the value of being a so-called tiger, yep, tiger mother, her name is Iris, American-born Chinese ABC, somehow ended up with kids who are Chinese-born Americans. So anyway, yeah, she's, looks like she's had some challenges. But this is not unuseful because not only does she understand that the right translation is eat bitter, but she understands the limitations of an unwise application of that principle guidance. So the page is called The Problem with Eating Bitterness. And she said, as tiger parents, most of us value grit and tenacity in the face of adversity. We appreciate mottos like, no pain, no gain. What doesn't kill you makes you stronger. That's Marcus Aurelius, I believe. If it doesn't hurt, you're doing it wrong. That's actually wrong. You may be doing it right and it doesn't hurt. There is gain without pain. Absolutely. There is gain without pain. But there's a lot of gain that requires pain. What doesn't kill you makes you stronger. That's not true also. What doesn't kill you, harsh catalyst, may associate to people being wounded and mentally, emotionally damaged for the rest of an incarnation. If it doesn't hurt you, you're doing it wrong. No. You can do something right, like I'm talking now. It's not, 10 out of 10, but it's good enough. It doesn't really hurt me either. If it doesn't hurt, I'm doing it wrong. So my talking now doesn't hurt. I'm doing this wrong. I don't feel pain. There's no gain. Not. Wrong. So be careful. A little knowledge is dangerous. It's got to be balanced with more knowledge to not become extreme. And eating bitter is surely not a call to masochism or self-punishing or self-limiting, yet limitations are inevitable in life, and making peace with them is wisdom and a great achievement. And knowing the bitter that is inevitable and being able to make peace with it is the work. And that's what I mean by assume loss. Assume there'll be loss. She goes on, the Chinese have a special phrase for this bearing of hardship, chi ku. It's a phrase that literally means to eat bitterness. Right. See, she's not playing games. Eat bitter. And it's something Chinese have turned into an art and a virtue. The ability to endure and overcome all kinds of trials is regarded as a fundamental part of the Chinese character. That's true. I live in Taiwan, you know. And there are Chinese cultural stoicism. Before Marcus Aurelius, the Chinese were stoic. 3,000 years ago, before old Marcus Aurelius talked of his stoicism, or the porch of Zeno's teaching, the Stoa. That's actually the porch of Zeno's teaching was called the Stoa. So the people on the Stoa were called Stoics. The guys on the Stoa listening to Zeno, I guess. Something like that. The Stoicism is a long tradition in Greek philosophy, and then Roman later with Marcus Aurelius. Good stuff, actually, but it has its limits. She goes on, whereas the American value of comfort often means avoidance of pain, Chinese culture accepts suffering as a natural part of life. And then she misquotes Gautama, or quotes with mistranslation, and puts the quote in as, all life is full of suffering, pain, and sorrow. No. That's called a fake Buddha quote that she didn't realize is a fake Buddha quote. All the first noble truth is dukkha. It's not too far from this quote, but it's not the same, and the detail is quite important. It's dissatisfactoriness. Dukkha is not simply suffering or pain. There's dukkha-dukkha and sukha-dukkha. And so sukha-dukkha is the dissatisfactoriness intrinsic to happiness and well-being, which is the fact that that experience is impermanent, it will degrade, and it itself is insubstantial. It's an insubstantial, impermanent phenomenal display. That's the problem. That's dukkha. That all conditioned, unenlightened experience, without having broken the ten fetters fully, is transitory and insubstantial. And you can't make a home and you can't find long-term well-being in the transitory and the insubstantial. All that we seek that gives us some happiness is transitory and insubstantial. That's dukkha. And so they work well together. Anyway, she goes on. We know how to survive, we know how to persevere, we know how to suffer. She's a tiger mom. But, she goes on, the very virtue that helps us survive tragedy and adversity doesn't necessarily help us thrive. The ability to eat bitterness can also threaten to poison us. And there's actually, she's Chinese American, American Chinese, but she understands Chinese culture very well. Says, unlike most Westerners who express depression through psychological symptoms, Chinese people typically manifest it through their bodies. Yes. There's even a term coined for this phenomenon called Chinese somatization. 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 Chinese somatization is the physical embodying of psychological distress or mental, emotional issues being physicalized, somatized, put into the body. Somatized symptomology, very common in psychology, but it's perhaps more common with Chinese culture and Chinese people. She goes on, the Chinese tend to experience their suffering through headaches, insomnia, chronic pain, fatigue, rather than emotional or mental distress. True. Chinese hospitals here are filled with people who have various conditions, headache, insomnia, chronic pain, fatigue, and want a shot and want a pill and trust the guy in the butcher jacket, the butcher coat, the white coat. And that's very disheartening, actually, because they support the big pharma business model of chronic ill health, chronic low-level ill health that brings them, keeps them coming in, keeps them coming back for more. So, go on, she said, it's no wonder so many of us experience pain in our bodies when we're taught to, quote, eat bitterness. The very language we use for suffering employs somatic imagery, meaning the imagery of eating something bitter as a sort of as resonant with the common application of that guidance that leads people to somatize their mental, emotional issues and distress and problems into body ailments. And it's again, it's a matter of balance, not too tight, not too loose. If you walk around as a curmudgeon, life is suffering, rah, rah, bah, humbug, Scrooge, that's too tight and a misapplication of the First Noble Truth understanding or teaching. Meanwhile, if you bip-bop around and think that you can make joy permanent, you're self-deceiving, and New Agey spiritual bypassers think they can chant their way to eternal bliss while they haven't broken the 10 fetters. So she goes on. We consume and absorb our suffering, but sooner or later our bodies betray our pain. And then she has a whole long thing about very, it's very interesting, a research article about Chinese beliefs and behaviors regarding pain, illustrating the cultural value of Stoicism. Asian Americans were the ones who reported lowest pain scores. Taiwanese cancer patient study indicates cultural acceptance of and high tolerance for pain. Long suffering. And so that's the far end of eat bitter. And she brings some quotes that people thinking this way or acting this way, who basically put up with more pain or expect pain, not, understanding dukkha as pain and suffering only, people become sort of depressive. And she said, people say to themselves, all marriages are hard. My parents weren't that bad. I can handle the pain. Well, actually, most marriages are hard. And my parents weren't that bad is not unreasonable because there's usually a mix of support and deficiency. So she's got her own stuff there, obviously. Maybe she doesn't want to think her parents weren't that bad. But in some sense, you can't know the balance until you've stretched first to the extremes. If you hate something, you might as well be honest that you really hate it. knowing that hate is a distortion and an emotion that you'd rather not stay with for the rest of your life. But if you have some faith in yourself, you can hate freely and grieve deeply and have some trust that you won't stay there forever. You won't get stuck in hate and grief. And so you can, I hate my parents, they were so bad. Well, okay, that's a first level extreme statement, if it's even, reasonable or realistic. I hate my parents were so bad. Okay. Is that the whole of it? Probably not. Meaning, maybe they were 80% bad, but they were 20% supportive and loving. Or their bad was the best they could do. Or they really were terrible and sadistic. Okay, well, that's that. But eat bitter, it's sort of a teaching to temper your enthusiasm. Temper your cheer as needed. Something like that. So anyway, she's talking about staying submissive and suffering unjustly. That's not what I'm talking about. Or she said, our ability to eat bitter thus becomes a badge of honor instead of a way to connect and empathize with others who are suffering. So she's talking about all sorts of excesses of a internalized attitude of eating bitter, where people become sort of pessimistic and even self-punishing, and then accepting of pain when corrective action should be taken. And so eating bitter or accepting inevitable loss or assuming change obviously doesn't mean no corrective action should be taken. There are cases when corrective action must be taken. There are cases when it can't be taken. You've got to kind of look at your own situation. So, in any case, the bottom, the deeper principle here is anicca, is impermanence. And it's a reality whether we like it or not. And accepting it is this sort of investing a mature recognition of it. And so when Gautama is saying that if you understand anicca, you understand the whole of my teaching, if indeed that's what he said, which I do think he did, this is a it's a critical object of contemplation, impermanence. And it's basically the easily observable basis of the other two, anatta and dukkha, actually. Because all is transitory, all is in change, and even that which is considered changing is in flux, changing. What does that mean? There's no substantial thing that's changing. There's change, and temporary appearances, and temporary mind states, temporary forms of objects, temporary forms of thought and emotion called mind states, or thoughts and feeling. All that is apparently substantial changing is actually insubstantial and sort of dreamlike. And the more quiet the mind is, the more one sees through Chittakash, Hridayakash, the heart field, heart sky, mind sky, awareness sky of mind, which is quiet, right? There's no wind blowing, or there's a gentle wind only blowing. There are no clouds. The temperature is warm. There's no burning. There's no shivering. It's a lovely solar sky, blue sky without much wind. By that, we can see that the mind states that we had thought substantial are not substantial, and we had thought impermanent are actually dreamlike in and of themselves, whatever that may be. It's basically flashing light, reflection light. It's basically pranic reflection. mind states or sankhara. Sankhara is basically like reflections of dancing light. The mind is the sense, is the sensing field that can cognize and conceptualize ever shimmering light. And the ever shimmering light takes the form of material objects and thought. And I think I'll close with what I've referred to a few times. Get to it. The famous dialogue between Manu and King Ikshaku. This is from Yoga Vashishta. That's a talkative bird there. And this is, again, English translation of Yoga Vashishta. It's not a pretty noise that they make. Or at least I don't think it's pretty. But it's louder for me than for you. From Valmiki, Advaita Vedanta. And this is chapter 117. Dialogue between Manu and Ikshaku. And let me just basically give you shloka 10 through 15. The king is asking Manu, what is the number of the worlds, the origin of the creation, the original state, the number of worlds, who's the master, when and by whom it's created, and how can I get beyond my doubts, and how can I be released from them? And shloka 9 through 15, 9, Manu replies, I see, O king, that you have, after a long time, come to exercise of your reasoning, as it's shown by your proposing to me so important a question as this, meaning, tell me about cosmology. 10. All this that you see, nothing real. They're merely phenomenal and unsubstantial. They, meaning all this that you see, resembles the fairy castles in the air and the water in the mirage of sandy deserts. So anything which is not seen, so also anything which is not seen in reality is accounted nothing in existence. Meaning anything that is not of the real has no substantial existence. That's anatta or sunya. 11. The mind also, which lies beyond the six senses, is reckoned as nothing in reality. But that which is indestructible is the only thing that is said to exist, and is called the tatsat, the only being in reality. All these visible worlds and successive all these visible worlds and successive creations are but insubstantial appearances in the mirror of that real substance, meaning tatsat. The inherent powers of Brahma evolve themselves as shining sparks of fire, and some of these assume the forms of the luminous worlds, while others appear in the shapes of living souls. Others, again, take many other forms, which compose this universe, and there's nothing as bondage or liberation here, except that the undecaying Brahma is all in all, nor is there any unity or duality in nature, except the diversity displayed by divine mind from the essence of his own consciousness, samvid. Sam is true, like sama, and vid is vidya, true knowing, or true consciousness. It's also satchit, satchit and samvid. 15, finally, as it is the same water of the sea, which itself is in the various forms of its waves, so does the divine intellect, the mind of Brahma, display itself in everything, and there's nothing else besides this. Therefore, leave aside your thoughts of bondage and liberation and rest, secure in this belief from the fears of the world. The fears of the world are the fears generated by worldly condition, worldly states of consciousness, consciousness below the diaphragm, lower triad consciousness states is the world, this world. And that's wherein we find fear. And purification of the lower, or of this world, of the personal world, lower triad, moves towards fearlessness, or slowly releasing fear, releasing the roots of triggerability to fear. Releasing fear, releasing deep fear, means dissolving the roots from which fear will be triggered by catalyst. The triggerability to fear, a fearful experience in the face of this or that catalyst, those roots get dissolved. And so the divine intellect displays itself in everything, and there's nothing else besides this. There's nothing as bondage or liberation here, except the undecaying Brahma is all in all, nor is there any unity or duality in nature. These are concepts, just kalpana. They're concepts associated with perception. Yes. People say concept, concept. Nisargadatta, screamed kalpana, kalpana. Kalpana is the result of limited perception conceived and thus believed to be experienced. We experience our conceived perceptions. We perceive with the five senses or with the mind sense. We interpret and conceptualize its significance. We experience our conceptualizations or interpretations of those perceptions. Perception, conception, experience. As perceived, so as conceived, or as perceived, conceived, so lived or experienced. Perception, conception, which is interpretive, and thus experience. I'm a happy guy because I perceive this or that and I interpret it as happy and then say, oh, I'm a happy guy, or miserable, whatever. But in truth, beyond all that fermenting fabrication, right? The sankharic fermentation fabrication process of conceiving, perceiving, conceiving, interpreting, labeling, concept making, thought form making of perception. Beyond that, there is no unity or duality. If I see many things, I'll call it duality or multiplicity. When there's a sense, there's the perception that all the many is in fact of one substance, light, is of one origin, is of has the same nature. The nature, the true nature of all phenomena being light. When I perceive that, then I call it unity. But actually, both duality and unity are appellations or conceptual fermentations, fermented conceptual labelings of perception. When at the end of the line, there's no more experience of unity or duality, there's inconceivability, there's non-conceiving, the non-arising of perception and vijnana and sankhara, of course. So there's non-conceiving in moksha, and that is knowing beyond differentiation. It's awareness beyond subjectivity. And yet to get to that profound understanding of impermanence is really quite critical. And it's the fast path, as Gautama really taught. And eating bitter is simply an experience that one that we ought to get used to without being morbid and expecting pain. Just expect impermanence. That's called reality. Meanwhile, the mind can be in a relatively long-term wellness with equanimity, but that equanimity is not the same as joy or the happiness that comes from a particular acquisition or freedom from something we didn't want, the releasing of the undesired or the acquisition of the desired. Those are acute forms of sukha. Long-term sukha is upekkha, or serenity, samatha. And that's very doable, as far as I can tell. But if you go to the airport, you might get razzled. You might get frazzled going into the big city. So in that case, so be it. All right, that's it. 1 hour flat. I hope this was useful. I hope you don't mind my rambling. These are interesting topics, and you can see that many teachers have understood the same principles from Buddha Dhamma, from Chinese Taoism, from Western Greco-Roman Stoicism, from Nisargadatta, from the raw material. They're all speaking on this great matter, the magnum opus, the great work. So, in any case, I hope you're well. Take good care of yourselves. See you next time, and good night.